we are happy to have today with us for our series of research seminars, Monica Pate from the Harvard Society of Fellows. Some of you may have heard her a few weeks ago or months, I mean, time flies. But now she will talk about something else. She will talk about approaches to scattering in quantum gravity and gauge theory from symmetry. Thank you very much.
Okay. So thank you all for attending my talk this afternoon. And so, yes, what I'm going to be telling you about today is a new approach to the scattering problem that arises from a study of symmetries in theories of gauge and gravity. And as Massimo said, I've actually recently visited NYU virtually, and so actually this talk will have some overlap with that previous talk, but I'll also be presenting some different material as well. Okay, so to get started, I'm going to frame the discussion by first posing what we might think of as the problem of quantum gravity. And so very broadly, that is, what is the microscopic structure underlying quantum mechanical theories that reduce to or reproduce general relativity at long distances and low energies? Now, we care about this question because we think it's fundamental, but unfortunately, it's also quite vague. So in particular, as it's stated, it's both unclear what it would mean to answer the question as well as where the challenges lie. Now, on the other hand, we believe we've answered this question or the analog of it for the other forces of nature. So in order to make this problem a little more concrete, let's start by re-examining that solution and remind ourselves what sorts of obstacles arise in the context of gravity. So one way that the microscopic structure is understood is through the systematic framework provided by Wilsonian effective theory. And so according to Wilson, the microscopic structure is captured by an action that includes all terms that are allowed by symmetry. So for example, in a theory of gravity, this is described by an action that includes all diffeomorphism invariant terms, or in other words, all scalar terms one can construct with out of the Riemann curvature tensor. Now, in general, there are infinitely many of these terms, but the Wilsonian framework is nevertheless useful because it also supplies a principle for organizing the terms. And that principle is that they're organized by energy. And so what this means is that if we're interested in physics at low energies and we have a fixed tolerance for error, so in other words, working to fixed precision, then there are only a finite number of terms that we need to keep track of. And as low energy effective field theorists, for each term we keep, we need to make a measurement to determine its strength, but upon having made a finite number of measurements, we can use our truncated effective action to make low energy predictions. So in this sense, the microscopic structure of gravity accessible at low energies is characterized by a finite number of parameters. However, if we start inquiring about physics at energies comparable to the Planck scale, then all the terms become equally important. And since gravity is non-normalizable, there's no consistent truncation to finitely many terms. So, the quantum loops will generically generate all the terms that are allowed by symmetry. And thus, ultimately, we lose predictability because we would need to perform infinitely many experiments to fix infinitely many couplings before making predictions. And so thus, the naive Wilsonian solution to the problem of quantum gravity is that the microscopic structure is captured by an infinite number of higher curvature terms in an effective action whose coefficients are in principle allowed to take any value and must be determined empirically. So at this point, we could simply conclude that we've solved the problem of quantum gravity by reducing it from a fundamental one to an environmental one. But this perspective is a bit disappointing. And so we'd like to see if we can tease out a bit more structure. And I'll now turn to a few standard ways that we know we can. Okay, so the first immediate objection to this Wilsonian answer is that there's an enormous redundancy in parameterizing the microscopics by different terms in an effective action, since actual observables are invariant under field redefinitions. So for example, in four dimensions, using field redefinitions to remove terms that vanish on the leading order equations of motion and dropping total derivatives, one can completely remove all the curvature squared terms. Now, in fact, we could have arrived at the same result in a much less painful way by simply studying scattering amplitudes. So specifically, if one writes down the most general three-point graviton scattering amplitude that's consistent with Poincaré symmetry, which is something that can be done actually quite easily now using modern on-shell techniques, then what one finds is that there are only two distinct structures. Now, the first one, which I've shown here, scales like momentum squared, meaning that we can identify it as arising from the Einstein-Hilbert term in the action. The other one scales like momentum to the sixth power, and thus could have only arisen from a curvature cubed term. So therefore, to this order in a low energy expansion, there are in fact far fewer independent parameters than one might have naively thought by studying the most general Wilsonian effective action. So the overall purpose of the slide, though, is really to point out that there's a more efficient way to attack the problem of quantum gravity, which is to focus on sharp questions that are phrased in terms of observables. Now, it's well known in quantum gravity that the construction of observables can be a rather subtle business, but nevertheless, the scattering amplitudes are a natural and well-defined set of observables in theories of quantum gravity and asymptotically flat spacetimes. So thus, a sharper question to ask that still retains the essence of the original problem of quantum gravity is, what is the space of consistent UV complete scattering amplitudes in quantum gravity? And this will be our focus. So now that our discussion has narrowed to the subject of scattering amplitudes, we should revisit and reassess the challenges. So while there are relatively few rules for constructing effective actions, which left the impression that there were a vast number of consistent microscopic theories of gravity, scattering amplitudes, on the other hand, are subject to a number of constraints and consistency conditions. Now, I think it's fair to say that we don't have a comprehensive understanding of what the full set of consistency conditions are. So for now, let me just mention a few. So the first thing is that scattering amplitude should capture causal and unitary physics. And mathematically, this implies that the coefficients that appear in a low energy expansion of the amplitude are subject to a variety of positivity conditions. And so what this means is that if one had just blindly followed this Wilsonian approach, one would have generically come up with acausal theories. So another condition arises from the observation that you can make a black hole by compressing a given amount of mass and energy within a region the size of its Schwarzschild radius. And mathematically, this implies that scattering amplitudes at high energies are required to emit universally soft behavior. And finally, scattering amplitudes are also required to emit universal behavior at low energies through what is known as the soft theorems. And what's interesting about these is that they are generally equivalent to constraints arising from infinite dimensional asymptotic symmetries. And a lot of my previous work focused on establishing different aspects of this general equivalence. So the point I want to make is that in light of all of these constraints, we arrive at a very different picture than we had previously. And namely, we see that we are very far from the sort of anything goes scenario, and rather there appears to be highly constrained structure underlying consistent UV complete theories of quantum gravity. And thus, now we can identify part of the challenge as being to find a uniform way to implement all of these conditions. Okay, so the rest of my talk will be divided into two portions. And the first part will be dedicated to explaining the general story of these new infinite dimensional symmetries of the scattering problem and their connections to the soft theorem. And so in particular, I'll begin by providing a heuristic argument for why one might expect gravity to emit infinite dimensional symmetries. And then I will explain how these symmetries constrain the scattering problem, and in particular, how the constraints are in fact equivalent to soft theorems from quantum field theory. And finally, I'll present a key insight that arises from this symmetry-based interpretation of the soft theorems, which is a new interpretation of infrared divergences and scattering amplitudes, and a more general understanding of how they can and should be cured. Now, it turns out that from investigating this new class of symmetries, one discovers that the scattering problem admits the Virasoro symmetry, which is the local conformal symmetry of theories in two dimensions. And so this simple observation will inspire a proposal that scattering in four-dimensional theories of gravity is holographically dual to a conformal theory in two dimensions. And so in the second part of the talk, we will investigate the consequences of taking this idea seriously. And in particular, I will explain how it motivates a reformulation of the scattering problem that addresses the challenge raised on the previous slide by encoding universal behavior at both high and low energies in terms of simple analyticity conditions. Okay, so with that, I'm going to begin this first part of the talk. Oops. All right, so for the purpose of this talk, our interest in symmetries will specifically concern their implications for the scattering problem. And to that end, I find it useful to start by laying out a clear picture of what I mean by symmetries in the context of scattering. So in general, symmetries can be thought of as transformations that leave the laws of physics, such as the equations of motion, unchanged. And symmetries of this form are useful because we can use them to obtain new solutions from old ones simply by acting with the symmetry. So the elementary example that we're all familiar with is that physical systems that are time translationally invariant emit families of solutions that are interrelated by simple shifts of the time parameter. Now, in general, the dynamics in which we're interested can be very complicated and we don't have access to full solutions. And in these cases, the scattering problem then provides an analytically tractable as well as intuitively meaningful approach. So that is, we ask the question, given the state of the system at some very early time, what will it be at some very late time? And here we usually assume that at early and late times, the relevant degrees of freedom are far separated and non-interacting, and all the non-trivial dynamics is then packaged in a map called the S matrix that specifies which final state is reached under dynamical evolution of a given initial state. So, and then in this context, a symmetry is a transformation that would apply to both the initial and final states preserves the S matrix. So what this means is that if we begin with a pair of initial and final states that are related by time evolution, then upon transforming the pair with respect to the symmetry, we again obtain a pair of initial and final states that are still related by time evolution. And so this is the sense in which, in the context of the scattering problem, we can use the symmetries to get new solutions from old ones. And so the key point to take away from this slide is that in the context of the scattering problem, symmetries are to be understood in terms of their actions on the initial and final data that's needed to specify the initial and final states. Okay, so with that introduction, I'm now going to provide a heuristic explanation for why we might expect infinite dimensional symmetries in theories of gravity. So let's revisit this example of time translations. And so as I just explained, in order to understand how these are symmetries of the scattering problem, then we need to consider their action on the initial and final states. So let's begin by imagining the region of space-time where the final state is measured and focus on the massless scattering problem in which degrees of freedom move at the speed of light. So what this means is we can think of this region where the rays reach after propagating for an infinite amount of time. And since a light ray can travel in any direction, this region should have a sphere worth of directions. And so this is colloquially referred to as the celestial sphere. So let's imagine that we place an observer at every point on this sphere. Now, if they reset their watches, which we can think of as implementing a time translation, since they're sitting at different points on a sphere of infinite radius, and thus will be out of causal contact with one another, they'll be unable to collectively synchronize the action of resetting their watches. So what we end up finding is that there's actually an independent time translation symmetry for each point we could have placed an observer, or in other words, each point on the sphere. And since there's a continuum of points, we get an infinite number of symmetries. So in other words, what we found is an infinite dimensional enhancement of the translation group. And these symmetries were in fact discovered back in the 1960s by the general relativists Bondi, Vandenberg, Messner, and Sachs, and they're called supertranslations. So I just explained that we should think of the region of space-time where the final state is measured as being a sphere of infinite radius that's reached by outwardly propagating light rays. And that's true, but the way I explained it wasn't quite the whole story. So to see what's missing, suppose you have a light bulb and you flash it at some time t equals zero. So as we said, the light rays that are emitted at this time will propagate outward to a sphere of infinite radius. However, if you flash this light bulb 10 seconds later, the light rays emitted at the delayed time will again propagate out to a sphere of infinite radius, but it cannot be the same sphere as the one from the original flash. And the reason is that these signals are both propagating at the speed of light, so the second one should never be able to catch up with the first. So what this means is that the region of space-time that's reached by all the outwardly propagating light rays can't be just a single sphere, but it also must include a time direction, which is usually called retarded time. So for visualizing these places, it's helpful to introduce a Penrose diagram, which I've shown here. And what it does is it depicts the entire space-time on one page. So in these diagrams, time increases as you move up the page, and light rays, which I've shown with these yellow squiggle lines, move at 45 degrees. And so also in order to represent, 4D space-time on a 2D page, every pair of points represents a two-dimensional sphere. And so here we see if we send light rays out from the origin, which is this line here, at some fixed time, then the place they eventually reach forms this sphere, which is represented by the blue line. And we clearly see on this diagram that these points are all out of causal contact with one another. And therefore, if we consider the place that's reached by all the light rays that are emitted over all times, we find this three-dimensional surface, which is known as future null infinity, and represents the place where the final state is measured in the massless scattering problem. So with this picture at hand, I can now provide a more concrete description of what supertranslations are by explaining how different solutions transform under them. So previously I said that supertranslations are independent time translation symmetries for every angle on the sphere. So let's suppose you begin with a solution in which there's a burst of radiation that comes out at future null infinity at retarded time t equals zero. So we can use an ordinary translation to relate this to a solution in which both bursts of radiation are delayed by, let's say, 10 seconds. And so the important point here is that under an ordinary time translation, the burst of radiation will always come out at the same time. On the other hand, if we use a supertranslation, then we can relate the solution in which both bursts come out at time t equals zero to a solution in which only the one at the south pole is delayed by 10 seconds, while the one at the north pole still comes out at time t equals zero. So in other words, synchronization of events at null infinity is not preserved by the supertranslations. Now, of course, this observation conforms with the intuition I gave previously that the different points on the sphere at null infinity are causally disconnected from one another, so the simultaneity at different angles is simply not a well-defined notion. Okay, so now that we have an example of an infinite dimensional set of symmetries that arise in the theory of gravity, let's try to understand what sort of constraints they imply on the scattering problem. And for that, we'll turn to soft theorems.
Sorry, Monica, may I ask? So how important here are the assumptions that all particles are massless? What if there are also massive particles here? So one needs to talk also about time-like infinity, right? Not null infinity.
Yes. So to understand, good. This simple picture of exactly how supertranslations act on particles that are massless, it's easy to understand if they're massless. There's an extension of exactly how they act on massive particles. So massive particles, of course, massive particles and momentum eigenstates don't reach null infinity. instead they reach time-like infinity, which is this point here. It turns out as that you can actually write massive particles instead in a different set of eigenstates where they do reach null infinity. And so that's one way in which you can understand how supertranslations act on them. Another way is actually just sort of formally through the soft theorem, through an argument that I'm about to present. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So, right. So let me just first have a quick slide on the gist of what soft theorems are. So now we're going to sort of switch gears and not talk about general relativity, but instead quantum field theory. And here we typically organize the initial and final data of the scattering problem in terms of particles. And so the scattering problem then becomes this question of given some set of particles with certain energy and momentum at some initial time, what are the particles we find at some late time? And the answer to this, to the scattering problem, or the solution come in the form of scattering amplitudes. And what soft theorems are, is they are a universal relationship between a scattering amplitude with a massless particle that is taken to zero energy and a scattering amplitude without that particle. And so, you know, scattering amplitudes are typically very complicated and can't be exactly calculated. So it's actually remarkable that such exact relationships exist. Now, the sort of physical intuition why they do is that at low energies, particles can only probe the long distance physics and therefore, you know, capture the universal properties of the scattering process. And what we're going to do now is see how the soft theorems can be interpreted as word identities of symmetries. So for the purpose of this talk today, we're going to focus on Weinberg's soft graviton theorem. And so what this says is that if one considers a scattering process in which a graviton is emitted, then in the limit in which that the energy of that graviton is taken to zero, the scattering amplitude develops a pole in graviton energy, and the residue of the pole, which I picked out by taking this limit here, is given by the amplitude for the that scattering process without the graviton multiplied by a universal number, which is known as the soft factor. And so here we're going to find it useful to parameterize the graviton momentum in terms of an energy omega, and a direction towards which the graviton is propagating, which picks out a point on the sphere. So now there's a systematic way to turn soft theorems, such as the one I just described, into statements of invariance of the S matrix under an infinite dimensional symmetry. And so this is the procedure. So the first thing is that we can regard this soft factor, SK, as the eigenvalue of a single particle state under the action of an operator, QH, or in other words, for like a hard charge that implements transformation delta that depends on the direction theta phi towards which the graviton is propagating. So then this right-hand side can be interpreted as the net transformation of the single particle states that comprise the scattering state under this transformation delta of theta and phi. So in other words, this soft factor, it depends on the momentum of each particle in the asymptotic state, but there's a universal formula that doesn't care about whether those particles are hard or soft. So this is the sense in which we understand, once I connect this to supertranslations, the sense in which we understand how supertranslations act on massive particles. And so what the soft theorem is telling us is that the S matrix itself is invariant under this transformation delta of theta phi of single particle states, provided that a soft graviton is F. So with this interpretation in mind, let us define a second operator QS for, you know, soft charge, which adds soft gravitons to the scattering state. So this allows us to write the left-hand side in a similar form as the right-hand side. And upon rearranging the soft theorem by bringing both of them to one side, we find that it is equivalent to the statement that the S matrix is invariant under a symmetry generated by a charge Q, which is given by the sum of this hard charge and soft charge. Now, since we can repeat this argument for every possible direction in which the soft graviton can propagate, we can conclude that the S matrix is invariant under an infinite number of symmetry transformations labeled by the point on the sphere associated to the direction of the graviton propagation. So the last part of the story is to see why the symmetries that I just described are to be identified with the supertranslations. And so in order to understand this, it's helpful to parameterize the symmetry by an arbitrary function on the sphere, f, as opposed to by these points. So upon doing this, what one finds is that the single particle states are again eigenstates of the hard charge, where the eigenvalue is now the energy of that particle multiplied by that function evaluated on the at the point on the sphere towards which the particle is propagating. Of course, this statement that I just said applies specifically to massless particles, and there's a more involved formula for massive particles. Now, in the case that we take this function f that we're parameterizing the symmetries with to be just a constant over the sphere, then the eigenvalue is just the energy. But we know that a transformation of a momentum eigenstate that returns energy of that state is just an ordinary time translation. So the transformation with this function f equals to one is just an ordinary time translation. On the other hand, if f is an arbitrary function on the sphere, then we recognize this as a time translation modulated over the sphere by this function f. So in other words, the function f is parameterizing the amount of time translation at each point on the sphere. And since f is an arbitrary function, this means that there's independent time translation symmetry at every point on the sphere, which is precisely what the supertranslations were. Okay, so now that I've presented a sort of general argument for why soft theorems can be interpreted as Ward identities of infinite dimensional symmetries, I'd like to describe some insights that we gain from actually interpreting the soft theorem in this way. So previously, I argued that we could think of a soft factor in the soft theorem as the infinitesimal transformation of single particle states under a symmetry. So now suppose we just decompose this single particle state according to its symmetry transformation. So in particular, what I mean is suppose we represent it by addressing, which entirely reproduces the symmetry transformation of the single particle state and some piece that is neutral under the symmetry. Now, of course, this decomposition is not unique since we can always shuffle symmetry neutral components in and out of the dressing without changing its transformation under the symmetry. However, let's start to fix this ambiguity by specifying that there's no interaction between this dressing factor and the Hadamard component, from which it follows that the S matrix acts. So why is this interesting? Well, as I'll explain, we can actually identify this factorization with the factorization of the S matrix into an infrared divergent and infrared finite piece. So how do we see that? Well, if we suppose this field C, which appeared in the dressing, is free, then actually any expression of involving this field C is entirely determined by its two-point function, and its two-point function is actually essentially fixed by Lorentz invariance up to some overall coefficient alpha. So that is, we can directly evaluate the part of the S matrix that depends, that transforms non-trivially under the symmetry. And what one can show is that by choosing alpha appropriately, you can entirely reproduce the non-trivial and intricate infrared divergent behavior of the S matrix. And so in particular, alpha here depends on the epsilon, where epsilon is a parameter that's regulating the infrared divergence, and G is the gravitational coupling.
So Monica, may I ask you, so because I understand this infrared divergences are specific to four dimensions, but supertranslations, they exist also in higher dimensions. So how does this get modified in higher dimensions?
So actually it's rather subtle, and I don't think entirely worked out in higher dimensions. You're correct that one can formally do this procedure in higher dimensions. I mean, to be fair, it hasn't been worked out, so I'm not exactly sure what the result will be. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Maybe I should also say there's a sense in which a similar thing has been studied. I can say a little bit more after I've gotten through a couple more slides. There's a sense in which a similar thing has been studied for example, the symmetries associated to subleading soft theorems. And they're not necessarily related to infrared divergences, but there's a reason why you might think you want to study something like this. But I think I can say something a little bit more concrete in a few slides.
Monica, I also had another question. So it seems so far you've considered just adding one soft graviton. What happens if you add multiple? Do you get more constraints, or does everything just factorize?
So at leading order, this symmetry, so the symmetry that we're talking about, you can consider sort of what the algebra is of this symmetry group, which you can map onto multiple soft theorems. At leading order, this is an abelian symmetry, so you sort of just get to add whatever you want. At subleading order, there's an analogous story that carries out for subleading soft theorems, which tell you about subleading orders in the graviton energy, and they are a much more intricate story. Is found. It can be studied, yeah. Right. Okay. So the point I wanted to make here was that we've learned that the factorization of infrared divergences and amplitudes actually follows from symmetry, in the sense that the decomposition of states into supertranslation charge and neutral components is equivalent to the factorization of the S matrix into infrared divergent and infrared finite pieces. However, now that we've recalled this fact of infrared divergences, we actually might be a bit worried about this program, since what readily follows from the form of this infrared divergent piece is that if you remove the infrared regulator, then all exclusive amplitudes vanish. And so thus it was one thing is, do infrared divergences sort of do this program and imply that the scattering problem is simply ill-defined? Nevertheless, given that this soft factorization could be understood in terms of symmetry, perhaps we might hope that the vanishing of the amplitudes can as well. And that's what I will now discuss. So to understand this, we need to back up a few steps. So previously, we had interpreted the hard charges as implementing this infinitesimal symmetry transformation on single particle states. So what about the soft charges? Now, based on the argument I provided so far, they just seemed like the price to pay for interpreting the soft theorem as a Ward identity. However, with this symmetry interpretation at hand, we should work a bit harder to understand the sense in which the soft charge is also implementing an infinitesimal symmetry transformation. Or to phrase the question more suggestively, we've seen that the hard charge transforms the single particle states. So the question is, what does the soft charge transform? So to answer this question, let's study the action of soft charges on the vacuum. Now, since the soft charges are comprised of zero frequency gravitons, they carry no energy and thus they can't change the energy of the state. So what this means is that if you act in a vacuum state with a soft charge, the only thing you could ever get is another vacuum state. So the soft charge must be implementing an infinitesimal symmetry transformation on the vacuum. So with this new understanding, let's revisit the word identity and take a closer look at the role of the soft charge. So as before, I've split the word identity into two parts with the contribution from the hard and the soft charge. And we already argued these hard charges implement the infinitesimal symmetry transformations on the single particle state, and they evaluate to give these soft factors. Now, to simplify the contribution from the soft charge, we have to do a little bit more. So since the soft charge maps vacua to vacua, let's label different vacua by their eigenvalues under the soft charge. Then, since the soft charge only carries zero frequency gravitons, its action on a generic state will still be given by the same eigenvalue, because we think of a generic state as that being that obtained by acting with creation operators for finite energy particles atop a vacuum state. So thus we have the same eigenvalue under the soft charge. And we can simplify now this left-hand side. And so we have this new form of the word identity. And so what we find now is that the solution to the word identity is at least one of the following must be true. Either the S matrices must all vanish, and or the difference in the eigenvalues of the vacuum must be equal to this sum of soft factors. So what this means is that if one assumes that there is a unique vacuum state, then the symmetry constraint forces all S matrix elements to vanish. Or in other words, a vacuum degeneracy is necessary for there to be non-vanishing S matrix elements. And on the other hand, if one allows for vacuum transitions, then the shift between in and the out vacua is determined by the soft factor.
Sorry, Monica, could I ask a question about this argument? So this sort of middle line that says that the scattering state has the same eigenvalue under the soft charge as the vacuum does, can you repeat the argument for that?
So I'm imagining that I'm building these general scattering states by acting with finite energy, creation operators of finite energy particles, a vacuum. But we already knew there was a form of this soft charge, which that only included zero energy particles. And so that simply, those operators simply commute with any finite energy creation operators.
Does that follow? I don't find that totally obvious. I mean, if a theory is free or something, then yeah, but why does it have to be true in general?
Oh, because these are written in terms of asymptotic creation annihilation operators, which effectively are free.
Okay, so assuming some sort of cluster decomposition or something. I mean, you need to assume that the creation operators for different modes commute.
Sorry, you're
working. Sorry, I'm at home and my internet is not perfect. You need to assume that the creation operators asymptotically commute. Is that the assumption that's being made?
So, you should think that this is analogous to if you write, you can formally write, momentum or energy operators that tell you what the momentum or energy of your asymptotic state is. And you can formally write those in terms of creation annihilation operators. And those you use the free field commutation relations. It's an analysis like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay. So the conclusion here was that non-trivial scattering requires a vacuum degeneracy. Now, to see why this is related to infrared divergences, let's examine states that carry definite value of the soft charge. Now, okay, so to understand how one might go about constructing such states, it's helpful to notice that the soft charge can equivalently be written in terms of the radiative gravitational field. So thus, states of definite soft charge are coherent states of graviton where the value of the soft charge is given by the zero frequency limit of the classical amplitude. Now, a class of such states were in fact previously studied by Fadiev and Kulish for the purpose of constructing infrared finite S matrix elements in QED. And more recently, it was shown that scattering states that obey the symmetry constraints, including generalizations of these Fadiev-Kulish states, are infrared finite. So what we've learned is that infrared divergences are not, in fact, an indication that the scattering problem is ill-posed, but rather they are simply a consequence of scattering states that violate the constraints due to supertranslation symmetry. And the reason why the Fadiev-Kulish states yield infrared finite S-matrix elements is because they satisfy the symmetry constraints, which is the general principle that's relevant for constructing infrared finite S-matrix elements. And however, since this symmetry only places a constraint on the low energy limit of this classical amplitude in the coherent state, there's no unique or preferred choice out of the family that's beyond those that satisfy the symmetry constraint. So in other words, there's only the symmetry really only constrains this zero frequency piece. And so Sergey, to your question earlier, there have been papers that then suggest that one should also be not only scattering states that satisfy the supertranslation symmetry, but also the symmetries associated to subleading soft theorems, although it's a little bit less clear exactly why you have to, because there's not actually an infrared divergence that is setting amplitudes to zero.
But also, I'm still a bit confused, because in higher dimensions, there are no IR divergences, right? So all this Fadiev-Kulish stuff is not needed. But on the other hand, supertranslation symmetries are there, so presumably naive states, they're not invariant under them, but still IR divergences don't arise. So
the full story is that supertranslations in higher dimensions are in fact it's a much more subtle, because they arise in four dimensions there's this fact that actually things that fall off with Coulomb power and things that fall off with radiative power appear at the same order in a 1/r expansion. On the other hand, in higher dimensions, there's a separation, and the radiative fall off is much slower than the Coulomb fall off. And actually, when you work out the story, you find that actually the supertranslations are telling you about a constraint in a Coulombic order. And so the full, that's sort of the now, but
this
full story.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
And sorry, you're using the usual physics rule that the last person who discovers something has that something named after them, right? Because before Fadiev and Kulish, Chang wrote this factorized amplitude keyball. There is a long story. It's a story that essentially goes back to Bloch and Norsic. Right?
That's right. It's
basic idea.
Yeah. But I should say, sorry.
No, please go ahead.
But I should say, one thing to advocate is that unlike a traditional textbook explanation that you usually find is which tells you that sometimes textbooks tell you that actually scattering amplitudes aren't observable. Instead, the only thing you can do is you can build cross sections. This is telling you actually you can also do it at the level of scattering amplitudes and obtain an infrared finite answer.
That's true, but Chang actually wrote amplitudes and advocated a formula for amplitudes, not for, and indeed not only him, but in a more rigorous way, and for, even though only for potential scattering, Dollard, even before him or contemporary to him. So this idea, I mean, this dichotomy in between summing over initial and final states or dressing states has existed at least since the 60s, but maybe even before then.
Yes, so I'm not saying that that this has been discovered. I'm saying that there's now this new interpretation of why you should do it, which is that actually they satisfy symmetry constraints. And this is like the general principle of how and why you should dress is the dressing should satisfy the symmetries. Okay, so that concludes this first part of my talk. And so the general message I wanted to convey is that the infrared sector of the scattering problem in gravity is tightly constrained by symmetry. But if we return to the motivation from the beginning, ultimately our puzzle with quantum gravity, of course, lies in the UV physics. And, you know, according to Wilsonian dogma, physics in the infrared is insensitive to physics in the UV, so we're in need of a new take on the scattering problem in which UV and IR physics are not entirely decoupled. Now, in fact, we already know of a class of theories in which UV and IR physics are related by symmetry. These are conformal theories. But of course, the coupling in gravity in four dimensions is not dimensionless, so there can't be a conformal symmetry in four dimensions. But in the second part of the talk, I'm going to explain how there's actually a conformal symmetry of two dimensions that does relate UV and IR physics. So in the previous part, we studied the leading soft graviton theorem, which is a statement that characterizes the universal behavior of the singular part of the scattering amplitudes in an expansion of outflow energy of an external graviton. But more generally, the scattering amplitudes admit a Lorentz expansion in the energy of the external graviton, where the leading term was the one that we previously studied. But this equivalence between soft theorems and symmetries actually extends to the subleading orders. And so it turns out that at the first subleading order, the symmetry that one finds upon sort of going through the logic that I presented in the previous part, that symmetry can be identified with a local conformal symmetry of two dimensions, otherwise known as the Virasoro symmetry. So based on this observation, it's natural to wonder whether there might be a conformal theory in two dimensions with observables that might be identified as scattering amplitudes in a 4D theory of quantum gravity. Or, you know, in other words, could scattering in 4D quantum gravity be captured holographically by a 2D conformal theory? And so, you know, on the one hand, this might be, you know, seems kind of exciting for prospects of investigations into quantum gravity, based on the observation that at least ordinary 2D conformal theories are constrained to emit a rather rigid structure. And I think it's fair to say that at this point, it's still to be determined whether there exists an intrinsic construction of such a holographic tool, but it's nevertheless proven enlightening to take this idea somewhat seriously by recasting scattering amplitudes in a manifestly 2D conformally covariant form. So in order to exploit this hidden 2D conformal symmetry, it first helps to understand where it came from. So in other words, why would we expect to find a two-dimensional conformal group, to find the two-dimensional conformal group as a symmetry of a scattering problem in four dimensions? And the answer is that the Lorentz group in four dimensions, SO3,1, is isomorphic to the global conformal group of two dimensions, SL2C. So the next obvious step is to try and make this symmetry manifest. And so the strategy will be to construct observables that transform simply under 2D dilations, which is the simple signature of conformal symmetry. And since we're studying the scattering problem, this means in particular, we should ask, what are the types of scattering states that transform simply under these dilations? Now, since the 2D global conformal group is really nothing more than a reinterpretation of the 4D Lorentz group, the generator of the 2D dilations must be identified with a generator of a particular Lorentz transformation. Now, we're used to studying momentum eigenstates, which diagonalize the translation subgroup of Poincaré. So this means that in order to obtain states that transform simply under the 2D dilations, we should instead diagonalize our states with respect to the associated Lorentz transformation. And as I'll explain in more detail, there's a natural identification between a generator of boosts and these 2D dilations, and thus we'll be interested in boost eigenstates. So to construct states that transform simply under these 2D dilations, the first step is to notice that massless momentum are naturally associated with points in two dimensions, namely the point on the unit sphere towards which that momentum is directed. Now, if you boost in that direction, that just amounts to rescaling the overall momentum by some factor, which therefore dilates, acts as a dilation on the sphere. So therefore, diagonalizing boosts along the direction of the momentum is equivalent to diagonalizing dilations on the sphere. So mathematically, to diagonalize these boosts, we identify the generator of the boost and then find an integral transformation that diagonalizes it. So this is like, for example, how the Fourier we use the Fourier transform to diagonalize translations. So in this case, the Mellin transform is the correct integral transformation that does the job. And so therefore, the procedure for obtaining boost eigenstates is to first parameterize the momentum in terms of energies and points on the sphere, and second, to Mellin transform with respect to the energy.
So Monica, I ask, it's related to the question I was asking previously, but on the what you're showing in the previous slide, relation between conformal group and Lorentz, like following from Lorentz group, that doesn't rely on particles being massless, right? So in principle, that argument applies to massive particles as well. So what happens for massive particles here?
So for massive particles, it turns out that, so the upshot is you still want to diagonalize boosts. The puzzle you come up with massive particles is, of course, there's no canonical way. If you have a massive momentum, time-like momentum, there's no canonical way to associate a point on the sphere with that massive momentum, which is obvious once you think of the fact that you can always be in the rest frame, and then there's obviously no point on the sphere that you can associate to that momentum. And nevertheless, what one finds is that, again, there's a sort of a transformation that does the job, and the point is that instead of having a simple Mellin transformation, you use a bulk to boundary propagator in ADS, a bulk to boundary propagator from like ADS CFT. So basically, massive momentums specify a point on a hyperboloid by the mass shell condition, and you use a propagator from a point on the hyperboloid to a boundary, which then specifies a point on the sphere.
Thanks.
An interesting actually aside is that if you're working with spinner helicity variables, then the mass of spinner helicity variables actually do specify a point on the sphere. Essentially, it's the direction with respect to which you diagonalize the little group. So if you're working with spinner helicity variables, there is a canonical way to associate a point on the sphere with a massive momentum as well. Okay. So the point is that if you do this procedure for every particle in the scattering amplitude, what you now obtain is something that people are calling celestial amplitudes, but that's simply represents scattering particles in boost eigenstates. And so often in conformal field theory, actually, though, people like to study it as a theory on a plane instead of on the sphere, but you can naturally identify points on the sphere with points on the plane via a stereographic projection. And then using these points on the plane, then the conformal group acts by Mobius transformations on these variables, and one can indeed check that if you take a momentum space amplitude, you do this transform, that indeed it transforms like a correlation function of local primary operators in a conformal field theory. And so here, delta and S are labeling boost weight and spin, which correspond to, or which in conformal field theory are interpreted as a conformal dimension, and then, sorry, the helicity is it labels boost weight and helicity, and which in conformal field theory becomes conformal dimension and spin. So now that I've sort of introduced this basic new idea for a new approach to the scattering problem, we want to sort of revisit these constraints. And the upshot is that in this language, they're forced to take a simple manifestly Lorentz covariant form. So for concreteness, let's focus on a 2-to-2 scattering on a 2-to-2 celestial amplitude, and start by just simply imposing kinematic constraints. So we can use, now that we've recast this problem in terms of boost eigenstates, we can use the conformal symmetry, and based on a standard result in conformal field theory is that a four-point function is completely fixed by conformal invariance up to an undetermined function of the conformal, of the conformal cross ratio. But, celestial amplitudes, of course, not only respect Lorentz symmetry, but the full Poincaré, and so they must be further constrained by translations. Now, translation symmetry is usually imposed by momentum conservation. So to see how this is captured in celestial amplitudes, first note that momentum conservation requires that all four momentum lie in a plane. So more specifically, any three momentum specify a plane in three dimensions, and momentum conservation forces the fourth one to lie in that plane. So this plane intersects the celestial sphere on a circle, meaning that the four points associated to these momenta are forced to be co-circular. And under the stereographic projection, this condition forces implies that actually this cross ratio is constrained to be real. So the upshot is that Poincaré symmetry seems to be telling us that the amplitude for 2-to-2 scattering is completely determined up to a function that depends only on the conformal dimensions and the real part of the cross ratio. And so this is nice, but actually we expect Poincaré symmetry to be more constraining based on what the story momentum space. So there, we know that we can use Lorentz symmetry. Lorentz symmetry tells us that the amplitude can only depend on the invariance formed by taking inner products of the momenta. And translations further tell us that only two of these are independent. So thus, in momentum space, all dynamics must be captured by a function that only depends on two variables. And we typically take these to be the center of mass energy and the momentum transfer. Now we can identify this ratio with the conformal cross ratio, so that begs the question, what replaces this overall energy scale? Now simply taking this ansatz and, or taking what we know about momentum space and putting it on the celestial sphere, we can answer this question. So in other words, taking Mellin transforms. So as I said on the previous slide, we can take this, we can take the dynamical part and parameterize it in terms of the conformal cross ratio and an overall momentum scale. The four delta functions which impose translation invariants, one of them must be telling us that this cross ratio is real, and the other three are constraining ratios of the energies. And finally, we can take the measure and rewrite it in terms of this overall energy scale and ratios of the other energies. And simplifying this, we find that we arrive at a decomposition where there's this first term, which is totally fixed by kinematics, And the second term, which is capturing the dynamics, is simply a single Mellin transform of the momentum space amplitude. And so what we've learned is that the entire dynamical content of celestial amplitudes is very simply related to the dynamical content of momentum space amplitudes, and the thing that is and what is traded for the center of mass energy is the sum of the conformal dimensions, which we're denoting as beta. Did I start at strictly at 3?
Well, at 2 past 3, you can take a few minutes if you need it.
Okay, so I'm sorry, I didn't quite time this correctly. okay, so maybe let me tell you. So one of the general physical pictures that we learned from looking at scattering amplitudes in this way is that they really don't obey this Wilsonian paradigm that UV and IR physics decouples. And the sort of physical reason behind this is that when one scatters boost eigenstates, they contain contributions from arbitrarily high energy. On the other hand, we actually understand different constraints that I mentioned at the beginning in terms of very simple analyticity conditions. And so in particular, we have a very simple diagnostic of whether a celestial amplitude is actually characterizing a theory of quantum gravity versus a theory of quantum field theory by simply looking at the analytic structure in this parameter beta, which was the sum of the conformal dimensions. And so specifically, there's a series of poles that would arise in a quantum field theoretic amplitude that are no longer there in a theory of gravity. And the last thing, one of the last points I want to make is that actually we also understand the sense in which celestial amplitudes are also constrained by the soft theorems. And so naively, this is a puzzle because the soft theorem was originally a statement about a low energy graviton, and now we're working in a basis that involves states that do not have definite energy. But again, here it turns out that the soft theorems imply that these amplitudes have to have very simple pole structure in the conformal dimensions of external particles, and the residues of those poles are universal and dictated by symmetries. And so, in other words, sort of the summary of it is that both UV behavior, sort of universal UV behavior and universal IR behavior are now known in terms of very simple analyticity conditions for these amplitudes. And we also have an understanding of both factorization and infrared divergences in this context. And so let me just wrap up and say that I began with this motivation that the scattering problem plays a central role in the development of our understanding of quantum gravity. And while there's really nothing wrong with the standard Wilsonian effective field theory approach, it obscures some interesting aspects of the physics. So for example, we know that there's universal behavior at both high and low energies in theories of quantum gravity, but it's not obvious how to simultaneously impose all these conditions within the Wilsonian framework. And so in particular, at low energies, the scattering amplitudes are constrained by soft theorems, which I explained are actually the constraints due to infinite dimensional symmetries of the scattering problem. And this new space interpretation led to a new understanding of the role of infrared divergences in the S matrix, and also how they could be cured. And then the observation that scattering in 4D admits a Virasoro symmetry familiar from 2D conformal field theories, guided us to study celestial amplitudes, which represent the scattering of particles in boost as opposed to momentum eigenstates. And in reframing a scattering problem, one discovers that universal constraints on both high and low energy in momentum space are actually instead captured by simple analyticity conditions for these boost eigenstate amplitudes. And so thus far, I've worked on sort of a preliminary investigation into the analytic structure of these amplitudes in terms of the conformal dimension, but one would also expect that there's interesting dependence on the conformal cross ratio. And indeed, results from the conformal bootstrap program might provide useful insight into such, or to guide such an investigation. So I'm sorry about the organization, but thank you.
Thank you very much. So please ask any questions. Sorry, I don't have the video. What's that? So please ask any questions.
Yeah, could I ask a question about these amplitudes, these celestial amplitudes? So you used translation invariance to decide that these correlation functions vanish unless all four points are on a circle, right? Unless the cross ratio is real. Is that right? So, but that means, I mean, that sounds inconsistent, or at least it sounds it would be hard for it to be consistent with the usual conformal block expansion, Virasoro conformal block expansion for a four-point function in the CFT, because if you had any finite number of conformal blocks, at least, I don't think that's consistent, right? Go ahead.
First of all, you actually shouldn't expect a finite number of conformal blocks, because there's not just Lorentz symmetry, there's also the translations. And so effectively, you should think of the translations as mapping you between different conformal families. And so if it's to be translationally invariant, you have to have the intermediate, there must be an infinite number of conformal families.
Yeah. Okay. And then is the idea that that might be enough? I mean, it seems clear to me that a finite number of conformal blocks can't reproduce that. It's not so obvious that an infinite number could, but is the claim that it can, or?
Yeah, so there's, I specifically know that, yes, some people have understood, yes.
Okay.
It's unpublished, but yes, it can be understood.
But I mean, so it's not really a local theory? Is that how I should think about it? Because I mean, if I do something like, you know, line up three of the points on your circle and then pull the fourth point across the circle, something strange happens to the correlation function, not at a coincident singularity, but just when the cross ratio crosses the circle.
Indeed, so this cannot be an ordinary field theory where you know that all the singularities are captured by an ordinary operator product expansion, right?
Right.
So, yes. Okay. I think, I think at this point, one of the most useful applications of putting reframing the problem in this way is actually to understand these subleading soft theorems, because they arise as sort of subleading terms in momentum expansion. It's not obvious, and if you try and look at their algebra and you try and look at especially looking at their algebra is quite subtle, because now you have to universal part is the coefficient of some power of energy, and energy is not a Lorentz invariant quantity. And so you have to take limits in a very, very subtle way. On the other hand, once you reframe it this way, it's a manifestly Lorentz invariant, and it's much cleaner to understand what you should do and how you should understand them, like the algebra of the symmetry.
It's interesting because, I mean, some years ago with Ben Freivogel, we calculated a four-point function in a theory in 2+1-dimensional De Sitter. So instead of having a celestial sphere at asymptotic Minkowski infinity, you have a sphere at future infinity of the De Sitter. And we calculated a four-point function, which had a similar property, that it had a kind of non-analyticity at exactly that point when the cross ratio was real. which we interpreted as meaning that it couldn't be a sensible CFT, but maybe it could be with an infinite number of conformal blocks. Anyway, it'd be fun to discuss that.
Yeah, I'd be happy to.
Other questions from students in particular? So, well, while people think about questions, let me ask a correlated question. One thing is to have a symmetry, to have, say, SL2C and the translation. A different story is to have a conformal field theory. Even if you don't want the theory to be unitary, still, why, for instance, you impose bootstrap or crossing symmetry? I mean, is that really a symmetry of your celestial amplitude, or is that something that you impose by analogy with amplitudes in a conformal field theory?
Well, I guess it depends on what you want to ask. So one thing you might say is, you might want to ask, is there right, it depends. So one thing that we understand, right, so if you were mentioning crossing symmetry, right, and that follows from there being the OP being associative, right? That's the consequence of the OP being associative.
Yes, but there is no reason to assume that there is even an OPE in your case, because OPE is a statement of some sort of locality in a conformal field theory, but your theory in a celestial sphere is not necessarily local, because you have, say, particle that comes from the center of the sphere, right, and then go to the celestial sphere. So how can you show that indeed there is an OPE?
There is an OPE, studied it. And so the basic idea is that actually, let's see, you might say, where did it come from and why do you have it? And the simple answer to that is that actually the operator product expansion on the celestial sphere is sort of the avatar of the collinear limit in a momentum space. So this is simply that as these points on the celestial sphere approach one another, this means that the direction of those momentum are approaching one another, which is precisely the collinear limit momentum space. And so, again, what we actually showed is that we showed that you can actually start with this sort of very simple ansatz for an operator product expansion, and using the different asymptotic symmetries, we were actually able to constrain the coefficient. So this is, again, so the ansatz for an operator product expansion essentially makes use of the conformal symmetry, but of course it doesn't constrain the coefficient, but nevertheless, because these different asymptotic symmetries are actually interrelating different conformal families, they allow you to constrain the OP coefficient. And so indeed, it turns out that the sub-leading soft graviton theorem implies this complicated symmetry transformation of operators, and indeed allows you to fix this coefficient up to an overall proportionality factor.
Thank you. Questions?
I believe Glenn has better hand up. Yeah.
Well, I was just going to ask, I felt like we sort of rushed you a little bit inadvertently at the end, or you felt surprised at what the clock was doing. And if you had a couple more minutes, is there anything you wanted to sort of say that you didn't get to say as completely as you had in mind? I mean, if fine, I just thought that it seemed like you had to sort of skip over a few things, and I wanted you to not leave feeling like you hadn't gotten to tell us your point, some of your points.
Yeah, I mean, I tried to sketch, I think, the things that I thought were the most relevant, which is, I mean, I think, as I see it, at the end of the day, you want to, okay, so the picture that I have in mind is that there's a bunch of new symmetries that we understand constrain low energy dynamics. And that's very beautiful, but somehow we want to learn something about UV physics from them. And the point at the end of the day is to say that actually this new way of looking at the scattering problem might offer a way to do that. And the idea is that both the UV physics and the IR physics are just simple analyticity conditions. And so if you understood a little bit better the rest of the analytic behavior, then effectively you would be able to sort of bootstrap low energy constraints to learn about UV physics. So that's sort of the point of this program.
Thank you. Actually, I may continue in this vein. First, let me check that I understood your argument. The OPE singularities are a manifestation of collinear singularities. Am I correct?
The OPE singularities right now are understood as a manifestation, yes, of collinear singularities.
And the second thing is, in some of the transparencies that you couldn't show, you discussed about the analytic structure of the amplitudes. We had some seminars recently in which there was a debate about what can you conclude, what kind of asymptotic behavior you should assume for scattering amplitudes. Is there a difference in the gravity amplitude versus a local field theory? So do you find, so what is the asymptotic behavior at large, S, say, that you impose for your scattering amplitudes in gravity, and is it different from what you have in quantum field theory? Does it give a different result on the celestial amplitudes?
So the first thing is that asymptotic behavior at high energies, so if you're talking about a four-point function, there's different ways you can take high energy behavior. And so the thing that is believed to be universal in theories of quantum gravity is if you work at fixed angle and take all the Mandelstam invariants to high energy uniformly. And so there, it's believed that that amplitudes are then exponentially soft in the energy center mass energy. There's a physical picture of what you should think should happen. Where is it in, and then that's to contrast in field theory where you expect that there's to be power law fall off. If you go away from this limit, right, there's a physical picture of what you expect, which is that if you instead think of your amplitude in terms of, let's say, center of mass energy and impact parameter, the basic idea is that if the impact parameter is small enough and that you can fit the center of mass energy into the size of Schwarzschild radius, then you should get black holes. This exponential behavior. Whereas if your impact parameter is large enough, then no matter how your impact parameter is large enough that as you send that center mass energy in, it's not within its Schwarzschild radius, then you're not gonna see this exponentially soft behavior. But I mean, I'm not saying anything. This is pretty, I think, well accepted, so.
Is that? I see that in your celestial amplitudes, you can see this difference in the behavior in the beta plane.
No, so the thing that's controlling, I say, the impact parameter is actually the conformal cross ratio. That's controlling sort of, I think, the angles. So like, you should think that This is something that we don't understand well. What's easy to see is the fixed angle behavior from celestial amplitudes, essentially because the conformal cross ratio is fixing the angle. But it's hard to see the forward limit, which is, yeah, has a different behavior.
Thank you. Other questions?
Okay. Can you
maybe
say
it? Maybe I should say that.
Sorry, everybody was talking at the same time. Sorry. Yes. Please, okay. Monica, go ahead, and then we'll Sergei will ask a question.
There's been a lot of this is. I should say, like, the Regi limit, which is the one that we can't reach, is the one that's actually, you know, sort of most widely studied and used. And used to, for example, find a bunch of positivity conditions on the different coefficients in the effective field theory expansion. And so the sort of puzzle is, how do you actually, like, how do you impose this sort of soft behavior at fixed angle on, let's say, like, the coefficients in the Wilsonian effective field theory expansion? And so this is saying, oh, like, this is a simple way that you can encode that universally soft behavior in this particular elasticity condition. So it should be, this, I think, should be viewed as complementary to a lot of the approaches that are being pursued right now.
Thank you. So now Sergei had a question.
Can you say a few more words? So you mentioned the, like, something like breakdown on Wilsonian UVIR decoupling. Can you say a few more words? What exactly you mean by this here?
Okay, so I think that can be easily seen sort of by a simple example. And so here, I'm just considering, let's say, scattering of four massless scalars that's mediated by a massive exchange in the S channel. And so, you know, in momentum space, we can just do expand this in small omega, and it has some low energy effective field theory expansion. Some low energy effective field theory expansion. But now let's consider what happens when we actually try and study a celestial amplitude associated to this. So we can try and look at first term itself. And if we do that, well, we can interpret it as being sort of marginally convergent. And so if we take this parameter beta to be imaginary, we can interpret it as a delta function. But as soon as we start adding subleading corrections, it immediately ruins this marginal convergence. So in this sense, it doesn't even really, these amplitudes don't really exist for, like, truncated effective field theory action, effective field theories. But on the other hand, if you just take the full amplitude and don't do this effective field theory expansion and transform it, well, then you find some nice, simple result. And so the point is that while in momentum space, you can truncate, and you can be at low energy and truncate effective field theory expansion, and your amplitude doesn't look very different. Here, you get a very, very different answer depending on what you do with, let's say, like, the UV physics.
Thank you. Other questions, please?
I'll just pipe up. I apologize, I have a bad internet and I'm not hearing everything all that well. But what could you just say in the next year or two, how you see this research program evolving? What's the sort of key thing that you think is sort of most fruitful to work on, and what kind of longer range things could develop? It's a kind of intriguing connection, I must say.
So one thing that I think is a very interesting question is how to understand if there is a first principles way to understand causality and unitarity in the language of these celestial amplitudes. So on the one hand, we sort of on the one hand, you can always just take everything you learn in momentum space and rewrite it in a new language. That's not particularly helpful. but I think that, yeah, so I think it would be nice if there was a sort of a more intrinsic understanding of what constraints, how those constraints arise in this language, and that would be helpful. I think another thing to say is that these amplitudes in some ways provide, we've learned a lot by taking apart moment and space amplitudes by doing things like, basically from unitarity, and we know how to sort of decompose those amplitudes and look at factorization properties. Here, there's just a different question to ask, because we have now, what's done in the conformal field theory, we have the conformal block expansion. So it's a different question of how you can take apart the amplitudes and sort of what the fundamental building blocks are. And in particular, if you take them apart with the conformal block decomposition, do you learn something about the spectrum or something of what's needed? And and the last thing to say is that, I have sort of said this several times, but I think that one thing that hasn't really been borne out yet that I think there is something to is I think there should be a sense in which we can learn something about UV physics from these infinite dimensional symmetries that constrain soft physics. And there's sort of a bunch of different ways you can go about this, generally things like dispersion relations and sum rules interrelate UV and IR physics. And that sort of thing just hasn't, quite been applied to these infrared symmetries. And in particular, some of these symmetries are new, like especially the subleading ones were not known before. And so I really think, I think there's still more to be learned from those symmetries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Monica. Please ask.
Yes. Sorry. No, go ahead, Dennis. Okay. No, so I'm a student, so I don't know too much about this, but I'm curious about the physical meaning of these supertranslations. For example, in one of your first slides, you showed that if you make one of those translations, the retarded time shows up when the two gravitons reach J plus. But if the gravitons take infinite time to reach there, how can you really measure a difference in time? If both of them need infinite time just to get to that point, what is the physical meaning of these new infinite symmetries that happen in a place that not even massive particles can reach?
Good. Okay. So one thing you might ask is I've said that there's these new symmetries. How do you actually check that these are symmetries of nature? And so essentially what they're saying is one way you can think of it is they're saying, I know some distribution of energy comes out from my scattering amplitude. And what the symmetries are telling me is it's telling me actually that the graviton field, at this very far away place is supposed to take some universal form. And really the part that's being constrained, the gravitational, the zero frequency part of the gravitational field is supposed to take some universal form. And yes, it's zero frequency graviton. So one way you can think of this is that this thing here, right, is really just like the gravitational field. And so this is telling me that in a in the scattering, the sort of the expectation value of the gravitational field at zero frequency, right? Or the pole at zero frequency is supposed to take some form. That's one way to interpret it, right? And so the point is that actually you can measure this because if you think about this instead in time, what this is telling you is it's telling you that this can be interpreted instead as effectively some total time derivative of the metric. So what it's telling you is that in time, there should be some permanent shift in space-time. And how do you measure that? Well, actually, you can just take particles on inertial geodesics, and the physical picture should have for what happens is before the radiation passes, you know, they're just traveling. As the radiation passes, like in LIGO, their positions start to oscillate. And after the radiation passes, they're no longer, their positions relative to one another are now still fixed, but they need not be displaced by the same amount that they were initially. So in particular, if you have a bunch of inertial observers everywhere on the sphere and you measure their relative displacements before and after radiation has passed, you can actually entirely reconstruct what this permanent shift in space-time is. And so this is sort of the physical picture of what's happening, or the physical meaning of the symmetries.
Thank you. So other questions? I mean, we had a long session, but we can continue, of course.
I had a couple naive questions, but maybe it stop me if people have to go or you don't want to answer it. One was, so traditionally I would have thought if you had something that was an exponentially suppressed amplitude, that your interpretation would be that you shouldn't be trying to describe it with point-like particles, but you should think of some sort of like Gaussian distribution of mass. The wave function of the particle wouldn't be a point. And I wondered if, so one question was, would that suggest that would be a better, would your work suggest that would be a better formulation of for gravity? And then the other really naive question was, when you do this boost basis instead of momentum eigenstates, is there any analog of a partial wave expansion and partial wave unitarity and things like that that are so useful in field theory?
So to answer your second question, yes, some of this has been worked out. At this point, I think based on the analysis that have been carried out, I think it's fair to say we're still trying to find the correct way to phrase the question. Like, we haven't particularly learned anything extremely insightful from that yet. Right, I mean, you know, it's the general thing that you want to find something. You can always calculate something, but you want to find something that's simple and then you have a nice interpretation of, and that has not quite happened yet. To answer your first question, I mean, I think So you wanted to scatter Gaussian wave packets and, as opposed to like point particles. Is that that's what you're
or? Yeah, it was kind of a dopey idea, I suppose, but I just was curious if it. It seems like you ought to be able to formulate a quantum.
Okay, so like,
why not?
Sorry? You cut out what was the last thing you said?
Oh, I just was remarking, it seems like you could perfectly well formulate it would be somehow causality and stuff might be a little more tricky, but I would think you could formulate a field theory in terms of some sort of Gaussian systems. I don't know. The other people in this call are much more expert than me on that, so I should just shut up.
Oh,
can I point out to one thing? I think that Glennis is referring to the fact that the amplitude at fixed angle was exponentially suppressed in the gravity regime. That's actually the statement that you form a black hole that whose size grows with energy. So that's a consequence of, in a sense, a non-locality, because you form a giant black hole and then that big extended state decays slowly. It's a slow resonance. Right?
I see.
But so that I think is what Monica referred to as the universal form of the amplitude.
Okay, thanks.
I don't know, but you said, Monica, that instead the Regge regime is still not well understood in your language?
No.
That's another regime where you can see non-localities. When you can see in string theory, you know that there is a Regge behavior, but that's not yet there.
Yeah, and also like, no, I mean, we really would like to understand it better because it also should be related to actually an OPE limit of the taking operator product expansion of the pair, so.
Thank you. Any other? So I think that we had a nice discussion, so we can let you go. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Seminar.
Bye.
Thanks a lot.